The thing about Home Assistant is that it's a very customizable product, designed to work in many different scenarios. Some people just want it as a home automation solution, others like it as a media manager. One of my favorite uses of Home Assistant is to manage and monitor all of the green tech in my home, such as my solar panels, my home batteries, my heat pump, and my EV. So once you've got all of those devices connected to Home Assistant, how do you visualize all of these things at a glance? You see, by default, you get just a blank dashboard or just a list of all the hundreds of controls and sensors for your devices. Well, this video is to give you a bit of inspiration. I'm going to show you a number of cards that I've put together that I think give you a great overview of all of those different pieces of tech in your home. Now, these are just a few ideas, and you can probably do a lot more or a lot better yourself. So please, if you've got any great ideas for presenting data or any interesting dashboard cards that you use, then please let me know down in the comments. And while you're there, please make sure that you are subscribed to the channel for free so as you get to see more of me. Let's take a look at my green tech dashboard then, and I'm going to start in the top left corner with this solar PV power graph. Now, this graph is plotting the forecasted power output of my solar panels overlaid with the actual power output throughout the day. You can see the dark grey line here showing the forecast and the orange filled section showing the actual generation. I find this really handy to see just how accurate the forecast was and whether I might actually be getting less than I'd hoped for due to it being extra cloudy or something. This card requires a couple of data feeds. Firstly, you of course need to be getting power data from your solar inverter. Now, hopefully you've already got that, whether that's directly from an integration that talks to your inverter or a separate power monitor. The second thing you need is to get your solar forecast. Now, you can use Home Assistant's built-in forecast.solar integration, but I strongly recommend you take a look at the Solcast integration. The Solcast integration is available to install using HACS. I'll put a link in the description to the HACS website for you, which has full instructions on how to install that. But the Solcast integration itself has a number of advantages over the built-in option. For starters, I find it to be a lot more accurate. I'm assessing other forecast solutions at the moment too, but Solcast at the moment I think is the best out there. The other thing it offers is multi-day forecasts, so you can get a solar forecast for a week into the future, and that will come in very handy for another card later on in this video. And while you are in HACS, go and install the ApexCharts card too. My solar PV card is an ApexCharts, and this particular card is highly configurable and can produce some great results. In fact, a number of the cards I'm going to be showing you today are all based around ApexCharts, so you really should consider this card an essential for any dashboard that you create. If we take a look at the card configuration, you can see it's not that scary. I have two defined series, the first one being the power coming from my solar panels. I've grouped the data by 30-minute averages to smooth the curve a bit, and also because the forecast itself is an average too. The second series takes the data from the Solcast forecast and uses a data generator to create the line of the graph into the future. Don't worry, I'll put all the configuration that I've used for all of these cards up on my website, speaktothegeek.co.uk, and I'll stick a link to that down in the description for you. Let's take a look at the second card on this dashboard then, and it's probably the most dynamic of all of them, the Powerflow Card Plus. Now, I love this card. I don't just have it on my green tech dashboard. I also have it on my main dashboard, and I even have it on my study control tablet. This is another card that you need to install using HACS. Just search for the Powerflow Card Plus and install it. No reboot needed. This card is so easy to configure. There's no need to dive into configuration files or anything like that. The whole card is configured using the GUI. You just go through each section, selecting the entities that you want to use in the card. I've pretty much gone for the whole lot with my batteries and my solar configured. I've got my carbon intensity percentage too, plus I have a whole bunch of individual devices defined, so as I can see if my heat pump is in operation or not, and how much my cooker is using. I want to point out here that I have the devices showing on the card even if they're not drawing power, but if you wanted a quick and easy way to see if something is active or not, then you can turn off the display zero option like I've done here for my EV charger, and it just disappears. To get your carbon intensity value, you can use the built-in CO2 signal sensor from electricity maps, and that will get your country's current carbon intensity value. But if you're in the UK, then your carbon intensity can vary massively depending on where you are in the country. So if you're up in Scotland, for example, then it's quite often very green because of all the wind power that they have available. I'm in South Wales and we're almost always running on gas, so our carbon intensity is a lot higher. I've got another video on grabbing your local carbon intensity value, so I recommend you go and check that out if you want something more accurate than CO2 signal can offer. So we're monitoring our solar power against the forecast, we're monitoring the power flows around our home, including our batteries and our heat pump, but what if we wanted more detail about what the heat pump is up to? Well, I made a video a few weeks ago about using an add-on called Emon CMS to collect data from your heat pump and display it in really nice graphs that are super clear to understand. You can see the flow and return temperatures, plus loads of other useful bits of information that help you understand the health or efficiency of your heating system. Well, the problem with Emon CMS is that you have to open up a separate browser window to keep your eye on that graph. So what I've done is recreate the look of that graph using an ApexCharts card. So on this card, I'm showing the flow and return temperatures as red and green lines. You've got the hot water tank temperature in blue and the indoor room temperature and the outdoor temperatures also displayed. Notice that there's like a yellow or orange section highlighted, which shows the period when the heat pump was actively heating the house. And the blue highlighted section shows when it was heating the hot water. You'll notice that I'm not showing the power input on this card because you can see that already on the power flow card, and I'm not showing the heat power output either because I've hit the limits of what this card can show. It's also not possible to show the SCOP or COP because Home Assistant doesn't have access to that data, but I have found this card to be very handy to see at a glance when the heating decided to kick in at various points in the day. This is another ApexCharts card, as I mentioned before, and therefore it requires lots of manual configuration. Most of it is pretty straightforward though. Each temperature line is just another series which I've tied to the left-hand y-axis. I've grouped the data by 10-minute intervals in order to smooth the lines out a bit. Down at the bottom of the config though, you'll see these two area type series. These are showing binary sensors for either the hot water or the space heating cycles. I convert them to show either a 1 or a 0, depending on whether they are on or off, and then display them on the right-hand y-axis. This nicely replicates the background highlight effect that Emon CMS uses on its graphs. So on to EVs then, and at the moment I'm still counting electric cars as green tech, although I'm sure at some point in the future they'll just become the norm. But for now, I like to be able to see at a glance certain information about my EV, and to do that I'm using the Ultra Vehicle card, which has the flashiest website ever. Now this card is, or was, great, but just before I started putting this script together for this video, the developer released a massive update which meant I had to totally recreate the card from scratch, and unfortunately it just doesn't display things in the exact same way that it did before. This is the card that I initially put together and I think it looks pretty good, but this is the card that I'm showing you now on my dashboard, which I'm not as happy with personally because it doesn't make as good use of the space as the old one did. But look, the developer is actively still working on this and releasing bug fixes every day or so, so I'm certain it will stabilize soon and be great again. But that's not even the worst thing about this card, because I've actually had to fake the whole thing for this video. None of that data or the controls are real. I've got an MG4 and I've tried using the SAIC add-on and the MG-SAIC integrations in order to get data from my car, and unfortunately neither method is reliable. It's not that they don't work, I think it's just that the car itself doesn't always respond to requests for updated data. I have the issue with the official app too quite often, it just refuses to update. Sometimes it works, but it wasn't reliable enough for me to show you in a demo because Sod's Law says that at the exact moment I needed to film this, then all of the data would be unavailable. So you can see here I have a fake state of charge and a fake range here just as a placeholder. But if you have a real working integration for your car, then you can of course use the real sensors. You can also add multiple icons that control things like your locks or the climate control, or they can just be for information only and show the status of things. You can install the card using HACS, and configuring the card is luckily all GUI driven, just like the PowerFlow Card Plus. You can set the title, vehicle information entities like its location and mileage sensors, and even upload an image to use in the card. The state of charge bar is just displaying the sock sensor with left and right side data for the sock level and remaining range also displayed. You can add other bars too if you wanted to. The icons are displayed in rows and I have just the one row in this example. This is probably the most complex part to configure because for each icon you have to configure the actions if you want them to do something and the states if you want them to show different icons or colours depending on the state of the sensor. You can even include templates in the state conditions like I have done here for the air conditioning. Now we're coming to what I think are a couple of really useful little cards. The first one displays the net cost of your electricity for each day of the past week. Now, it uses the ApexCharts card again, and I'll show you the configuration for it in a second. But before you can configure the card, you're going to need to make sure that you are collecting the data for it. To do this, you should create a template helper sensor, and I've called mine Electricity Net Cost. I already have the Octopus Energy integration up and running, and that provides me with a sensor containing the current accumulative costs for my imported electricity that day, and that includes the standing charge. So I take that value and deduct what I was paid for my exported energy that day, which is calculated by multiplying my export rate from the Octopus Energy integration again, by the amount of energy I have exported so far that day, which is tracked by my smart meter. Once you've had that sensor up and running for a few days and it's got plenty of data in it, you're ready to create the card. Most of the effort in creating this card was actually cosmetic, making it look nice and getting the labels to look correct. If we look at the card configuration, you can see I had to fiddle around to get the y-axis to show the currency correctly, and that was the same for the labels on each of the bars too. The actual series configuration was a straightforward column chart, and I grouped the data by the last value for each day. If you copy and paste this chart configuration and you've called your cost tracking sensor electricity net cost the same as me, then this card should work as is with no changes needed at all. Now to the other of those extremely useful cards, one showing the solar forecast for the week ahead. It's always handy to know which days in the upcoming week are going to be the sunniest. It can help you plan when you're going to be doing your washing, for example. This card relies on the Solcast integration. You can see at a glance the expected generation for today and the whole week ahead. The values are displayed on each bar for a quick reference. If you are using the Solcast integration to provide your forecast data, then you should be able to just copy and paste my configuration here exactly as it is. All it does is take the various days ahead forecast entities and whack them into a data generator to tell the card that those entities are providing a value for that specific day on the chart. There's nothing that clever about it, but it's simple and effective. And then there's that multicoloured chart of ribbons that really stands out on the dashboard. This is called a Sankey diagram and is designed to show the flow of data from left to right. In this case, I'm using it to show the sources of all of my energy on the left, so that could be from my solar panels, batteries or the grid, and where it all went to on the right. I've actually made a whole video about the Sankey chart card, so I'm going to point you in the direction of that. You can configure nearly all of it now using the GUI, and in that video I showed you how to configure it to display power flows. But here, I've actually used it to show energy. Now I think this card works best with power flows because with power it tends to show pretty accurately the live data, but with energy then it can go a little wonky. So for example, if you look at this diagram today, it looks like all of my solar generation so far has gone straight into the home demand, but my battery has provided the export. Now all of the numbers add up, but I know for certain that the flows are not correct because, well, I'm exporting right now from solar if you look at the power flow card. This is because it's actually taking the total energy values for today so far, and because the home demand has been more than the solar generation so far, then it has assumed that it must have all gone into the home. It's just not clever enough to split it up properly, but it does look very pretty on the dashboard. And then we come to this last little section which I didn't really know what to do with, so I've stuck in a few random but useful cards which are pretty specific to just me. Top left is a gauge that tells me how much energy is left in my batteries. This is calculated in a template helper by multiplying the known capacity of my batteries, which is 21.7 kilowatt hours, by the remaining state of charge percentage of my batteries. It's a very rough estimate because many factors can impact upon the actual amount of energy available for you, but it's good enough as a guide. Then we have a little spinning fan icon. I've fitted a fan to the top of my solar inverter and it's powered through a smart plug. I've got an automation running that is monitoring the temperature of my solar inverter, and when it hits a specific threshold, it turns it on to help cool it down by increasing the airflow around it. I thought it was quite handy to see when the fan was on, and it's also nice to see the fan animation too. Underneath those icons are some power gauges for my batteries. I've got two batteries, so it's handy to see the SOC percentages for each of them separately. To create these cards, I've had to use a few extra components that I installed using HACS. Firstly, I've used stacking cards, which lets me merge multiple cards into something that looks like one card. If you look at the cards, you'll see it's actually three in one. We have the power gauge at the top, then there are two smaller cards displaying the SOC and the status of eco mode. So to create these cards, you need to install stacking card to give you the new flexible card layout types, mushroom cards, which gives you loads of fancy customizable card types, card mod, which lets you add custom CSS code to any dashboard card you like for the ultimate in customization. And you may also have noticed the color gradients on the gauges. These are generated using the amazing website called HA Rainbow Generator, and I'll put a link to that down in the description. You can choose your colour scheme, number range for your gauge, and how many segments of colour you want, and it'll generate the configuration for you to copy and paste. The more segments you generate, the smoother the rainbow effect will be, but the longer the configuration is as a consequence. Anyway, I hope that you found this useful. If you did, then please give the video a like and subscribe to the channel for free to see more from me. Check out the links in the description to my website where I will put all of the configuration that I've shown you in this video. And while you're there, why not consider becoming a member like these amazing people here? In return, I'll give you early access to my videos and some bonus content too. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.